Well, 2016 hasn't yet concluded, but it certainly is a litany of shattering and frightening events. And when we look globally at some of the situations that have happened over the world, of course, we are becoming a little bit insulated to the common factor of terrorism. It's in our newspapers, it's reported, we read it, and I wonder if sometimes we're becoming a little bit more isolated from the reality of what occurs in many parts of the world. And as we consider 2016, I guess I could have put up a number of shots of different incidents that have occurred throughout the earth over the last year. You might remember the Brussels airport incident. You might remember the terrorist truck in Nice in France on Bastille Day. Syria, Orlando, the nightclub there, Istanbul, the Ataturk airport. All of these have been some of the events that have happened with rapidity through 2016, so much so that I'm sure that we've forgotten half of them already. Well, the picture I've chosen is this one here, and there's a reason for that. It actually is a terrorist event that happened in Lahore in Pakistan. None of us probably heard about it. I didn't even know about it. When I did a little bit of research on terrorism activity in 2016, there were page after page of activity that's happened that we don't even hear about. 29 children died in this particular event. So, of course, it's become quite commonplace. So I think the key word for us when we're thinking about 2016 and the events that have happened is this particular word here, the word uncertainty, isn't it? We just don't know what's going to happen in our world in the next day or week or month or year. So this word uncertainty really characterises, I think, the fragility of today's world in that we just don't know where this world is heading as far as humanity is concerned. But I don't want to just focus on the problems tonight. I mean, there's an obvious answer to the question, really, isn't it? When we think about 2017, is it going to get better for all of us globally? Well, of course not. And that there's a reason behind that, and the reason is because humanity is in charge of many of the decisions that are made. Of course, they're not wise decisions. So none of us are expecting in 2017 on a global scale for life to get better, that there will be satisfaction and security for people everywhere, that all the problems that we face, environmental problems, climate change, is that going to be solved in 2016? Economics, morality, and again, the disparity of resources between the rich and the poor, is that going to be solved in 2017? From a human perspective, well, no, it's not. And there's a reason for that. We have 6,000 years of history, which we can sort of resource, and we realise that, well, we're not finding solutions to our problems. In fact, I think it's a little bit presumptuous for us here in Western countries to ask the question, is 2017 going to be different? Because we're better off than 99% of the rest of the world. We're not really in touch with the reality of what's going on in today's world. Because we live in Australia, we have lots of freedoms, we have independence, we have security, we have prosperity. So we're a little bit disconnected from the reality of the world's problems. And the fact is, for all of us, if we've got food in the fridge, if we've got clothes on, we've got a place to sleep, we're better off than 75% of the rest of the world. Well, that's 5.8 billion people. So you sitting here tonight are ahead or have more privileges, more resources than 5.6 billion people. That's frightening. I mean, we think this is normality. We think the conditions that we enjoy here are all over the world. Well, no, they're not. And in fact, if you earn more than $50,000 annually, which some of us might do, and certainly in Australia there are plenty of people that do that, we're in the top 1% of the population of the world. So if we earn that sort of amount, we're better off than 7.3 billion people. Those statistics are quite frightening and challenging. So the reality is, as we've progressed through history over the last 6,000 years or so, there's an ever-widening gap between the rich and between the poor. That's incontestable. And we've become better really at destroying our world than we have creating and progressing it for everybody. So there's continual social unrest that's been developing, and you'll be aware of the massive shifts in refugees and people that are dissatisfied with their own country. So the United Nations High Commission for Refugees just released their report a couple of months ago, and the figures are quite staggering. When you think about it, there's 65 million displaced people in today's world. Now, we just think of the terms of Australia's population, multiply that by three, that's the number of people that have been displaced in the world in the last year. Half of those are children. So we've got something like 30 million kids who are wandering around this globe looking for a home, looking for a place of security. It's astounding. And if we would take this particular statistic of 65 million and relate that to a country, that would be the 24th largest country in the world of refugees, of people that have no home. So these figures are quite alarming. And in fact, Ontario Guterres, who is the Commissioner for the United Nations Refugees, made this little comment when this report was released a couple of months ago. He said, "We're witnessing a paradigm of change, an unchecked slide into an era in which the scale of global forced displacement, as well as the response required, is clearly dwarfing anything seen before." So we've not seen 65 million people shifting themselves around the globe in search of some security. We haven't seen those statistics before. And he goes on, he says, "It's terrifying that on one hand, there is more and more impunity by those starting conflicts, i.e. those countries responsible that are creating these areas of warfare. And on the other side, there is a seeming utter inability of the international community to work together to stop wars and build and preserve peace." So he's basically saying, here's the report. There's 65 million people that are displaced and we've got no answer and it's getting worse. So you'll notice this little comment down here, which you might be able to read, that it says there, we are now coming to the greatest levels of displacement in record. So these particular statistics haven't been heard of before. Now I want to balance this by not just highlighting all the issues and the problems. You know, there are some areas in our world where there have been improvements. So I'm now going to show you a little clip which was put out by what's called the Global Peace Index. It's the Department for Economics and Peace. So this is a global think tank that analysed something like 23 different data statistics to evaluate, well, how secure and how peaceable is the world? Are we improving or are we going backwards? So this is what I might call a balanced report. It's not sort of just talking about terrorism and the terrible effects of our world, it's balancing everything up. So I'm just going to play that clip now and let you have a listen to that.
In the 12 months since the last Global Peace Index, increased conflict, terrorism and the refugee crisis suggests a less peaceful world. However, despite the increasing inequality between peaceful and less peaceful nations, there are positive trends where the data tells a different story. This 10th edition of the Global Peace Index, which analyzes 23 types of data across 163 countries, finds that the gap between the most peaceful and the least peaceful countries continues to widen. The world has become 2.4% less peaceful over the past decade, but some of the most peaceful nations have reached the highest ever levels of peace. The decline in peace since last year is driven by conflict in the Middle East and North Africa. Syria ranks the world's least peaceful country, with South Sudan, Iraq, Afghanistan and Somalia close behind. Deaths from terrorism have increased by 80% in the last year to an all-time high. The economic cost of violence in 2015 was $13.6 trillion, the equivalent to $1,876 for every person in the world. Yet again, the world spends a lot on violence, but very little on building peace. However, there is good news. Today, 77 countries are more peaceful than 10 years ago, with some the most peaceful that they have been in recorded history. Iceland is once again the world's most peaceful country. Denmark, Austria, and New Zealand follow closely behind, with Portugal joining them in the top five for the first time. There has been a renewed effort by the international community to provide timely funding and support to peacekeeping operations. As we reflect over 10 years of the Global Peace Index, terrorism is at an all-time high, battle deaths from conflict are at a 25-year high, and refugee numbers are at a level not seen for 60 years. However, it is important to note that these three dynamics are driven by just a handful of countries, demonstrating the global repercussions of breakdowns in peacefulness. For 10 years, we have focused on understanding the dynamics and drivers of peace in order to provide the world with a roadmap for creating a more peaceful future.
So you can see that's a fairly well-balanced report globally of how our world is performing. And in fairness, they say there are some countries that have improved and that it is a secure and peaceful place to live. Of course, I'm not quite sure I want to go to Iceland, or maybe even New Zealand. But, you know, there is a minority of countries where, and perhaps even Australia, there's a reasonable amount of security, and that's nice. But again, statistically, when we're talking globally, this is a massive problem. And as this institute pointed out, we are reaching terrorism all-time high, battle deaths a 25-year high, refugees the highest in 60 years. So, not a good report at all. But the question, friends, is not so much, well, what's happening in the world and what's going to happen in 2017? The question is, what are you doing about your world? Most of us can't influence what's going to happen on the other side of the globe. We don't have positions of authority. We're not involved in politics. So the question really becomes, for ourselves, what are we doing about our world? And we want to give you an option tonight, which you might not have considered, that we believe will provide not only security, but a wonderful vision of hope for the future and for humanity as well. So we want to just sort of step back really and look at the picture of the big world in the context of, well, what about my life? How do I integrate what's happening in the world in 2017 with my life? And it's important that we have a look, I think, at Bible prophecy, because this is one of the beautiful aspects of the scripture that gives us hope and confidence that there is some light, there is security, there is prosperity for the future. Sadly, in many of the churches today, they look at the Bible and they just see it as a bit of a guidebook, a bit of a manual for how to live life here and now. And if we live a good life, well, that's a good thing, and this is a wonderful little book about that. Well, there's a greater depth to the scripture, and of course, prophecy here is particularly important. And the point of prophecy is that it focuses on the reality of the return of Jesus Christ and some practical and real changes that God has determined for his world to institute through Jesus Christ and those that are qualified to live and reign with him. So of course, when we talk about Bible prophecy, it does take a global perspective, but particularly focuses on the area of the Middle East, which that previous report highlighted was the cause of much concern and conflict. So when we step back and we look at the world and we look at the changes that are going on, particularly in the Middle East, you know, what have we noticed over the last year or so? So we're not just, you know, cherry picking little points, we're stepping back and we're saying, well, how's the world progressed? What's happened? So we've seen a massive shift in relation to the Western interests in the Middle East, and of course President Obama, who's now been displaced, now President Trump. Previously, the administration withdrew their support from the Middle East, which was interesting, and that opened up a geopolitical change for Russia. And we've noticed as well the last year or two that Mr. Putin has been quite definite in what he's going to do and how he's going to change the world, which is in accordance with Bible prophecy. And on top of that, the next layer is, of course, a divided and fragmented Europe. And if you know a little bit about Bible prophecy, Daniel chapter 2, which we're not going to really look at tonight, but of course it gives that image, it gives the fragmented feet, which were the extension of the Roman Empire, i.e. Europe. And of course, I don't have to prove to you that Europe is fragmented. We've just seen it in the last few months with the vote for Brexit, for Britain to exit out. And of course, they said that this is not the first of the nations who will perhaps agitate for disconnection from the European community. So that's what we've seen. That's a bit of a snapshot of today's world. And what we want to have a look at tonight is Daniel chapter 11, because Daniel chapter 11 is a wonderful prophecy that takes historical events, which we've seen, we can prove, but it also moves into the future. So that little section that Matt read for us tonight really highlights what we haven't yet seen. So this is going to be quite interesting for us as far as, well, 2017 and beyond if our Lord doesn't return earlier. So what's Daniel 11 all about? It's a long chapter, isn't it? 45 verses, you know, it looks like there's two or three pages here. Well, there's an angel that reveals to Daniel some of the historical events that are going to occur. And I'm not going to go into, obviously, all the historical details here, but you can see a bit of a snapshot. Daniel lived in this particular time, Darius the Mede, so he's right back here, you know, BC 550, 600. So he lives here, and he really plays out some of the events that will happen here, particularly conflicts between the king of the north and the king of the south. So there are sort of periods here, Roman period, right through to the latter days and beyond. So it's a very comprehensive chapter, is Daniel chapter 11. And the focus is, of course, on the Middle East. Well, rather than all that history, let's just look at a map and let's compress that all down. What's Daniel 11 about? It's about the king of the north and the king of the south and the interaction between them. And Israel happened to be sandwiched in between the midst of these two antagonistic powers. So here's a map. And here's the king of the north area. This was called the Seleucid Empire. So after Alexander, there were four generals, and his empire was broken up into four sections. There were two important sections. One was the Seleucid family, and the other were the Ptolemies down in the south. So there was always this interaction here. Jerusalem happened to be in the middle. Essentially, that's what Daniel chapter 11 is all about. It's actually 2,600 years of history. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? Like, when you hold up that piece of paper there, you're talking 2,600 years of history on that page. It's quite astounding. So we say 2,600 years of history, but more accurately, it's actually 2,600 years of angelic supervision and influence. You see, these historical events that we're looking at here just didn't happen randomly. They were predetermined by God, and the angels behind the scenes have been working amongst the empires of men to give them direction and to conform to the written documentation of Daniel chapter 11. That's quite astounding. So what we've got on this little page here that we're holding is 2,600 years of Bible evidence that God exists and the angels are working in the nations. That's quite astounding, and we want to explore that a little bit more, because this chapter goes on to chapter 12, which we didn't sort of read, but of course this is a future time. Chapter 12 verse 1, look at what it says. At that time shall Michael, this is an angel, a powerful angel, he will stand up, the great prince which stands for the children of thy people, i.e. the nation of Israel. There'll be a time of trouble such as never was, but thy people will be delivered. He's talking now, these events flow into the return of Jesus Christ. And we know that because verse 2 says, many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life. So this is a really beautiful section that traces 2,600 years of history, but doesn't stop there. It goes into the future and says the results of this will be in the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, when God's people will be delivered. And of course, we want to be part of God's people. We want to be part of that solution. So, of course, when we're talking about Daniel chapter 11, it's not just a history lesson. You know, we can get bogged down in all the details of the Seleucids and the Ptolemies and all of that, but in essence, we want to stand back and we say, you know what? This page, these couple of pages, are the evidence of the angels at hand, and they're working through the nations of the world to create eventually the kingdom of God upon this earth. So that's something very positive that we want to have a look at. So there are something like 135 prophecies in this particular chapter. So when we look at the statements, everyone has been positively proved throughout history. So it contains over 100 projective prophecies, of course, from the time of Daniel. You know, he's 600 years before Christ, so it's a long way back, but we can see the flow of events now. There's no supportive evidence in history to contradict any of these declarations. Everything prophesied has come true so far. They provide a convincing background to the end time event. So, you know, what guarantee have we got that verse 40 through to chapter 12, verse 2 are going to be fulfilled? Well, hello, 100 prophetical events in the previous context have already been fulfilled. Why wouldn't they be? We've got God's guarantee that that will happen. So that's that particular point there. So, of course, this becomes a very powerful tool that gives us confidence in today's world. Is Jesus Christ going to come and return? Is the world going to get better? Yes, according to the Bible, and we want to be able to connect into that. We want to become part of that. We don't want to become part of the disturbances and the confusion, the anxiety and the disappointment that are the symptoms of today's world. So we need to have a look at Daniel's end time prophecy. So there's a key word. When we have a look at chapter 11, again, and I've got these coloured in, it's a great little colouring exercise if you've got nothing to do, it's the word stand. Right through Daniel's prophecy here, something like 19 times, there's a key word, stand. And what it is, it's the kingdoms of men standing up and saying, well, I'm powerful, I'm going to take control. So the king of the north and the king of south would stand up and say, well, I'm going to be dominant in the world, and I'm going to give control, and I'm going to take authority for decisions. So there's an interaction of all these powers that are standing up. But of course, chapter 12 and verse 1 says at that time, Michael will stand up. So that's the answer to all these other kingdoms trying to stand up. In the end, Michael, the angel, alongside the Lord Jesus Christ, with the Lord Jesus Christ, will stand up to build the kingdom of God. So there's a very positive end to this chapter. It would have been quite refreshing for Daniel to know that in the end the kingdoms of men would not prevail, and we see their failure in 2016, But eventually, of course, the kingdom of God would be established. So as we say, there's a lot of events that happen and powers trying to make a stand. But Michael, of course, will stand up, and the prophecy of Daniel finishes very beautifully in chapter 12 and verse 13. Daniel, go your way, because one day you will stand in your lot at the end of the days. I think it's just lovely how the prophecy of Daniel finishes with that personal encouragement. He's seen a lot of history. He was interested in what's going on in the world. There were kingdoms of men that were standing up, and Daniel sort of steps back and he wonders about what's the end result. And the angel says, Daniel, it's all going to be okay. You're going to stand up and you're going to become part of the kingdom of Christ. And then that's the end of Daniel's prophecy. It's the end of the book. So it's sort of a really lovely, maybe even emotional thing for Daniel to have that key word of stand embedded in his mind as the angel revealed to him history. So as we said, we're not going to get fully involved, but this is just a bit of a snapshot of the interaction between the kings of the north and south. Okay, so here we go through history. Here are the different invasions. Here are the southern kings or the southern power. Here's the Norman, the Seleucid, the Antiochus. And these are the events that are traced through chapter 11. If we were going to go into detail, of course, and you know a little bit about history, well, there's all the Ptolemies. And here's all the northern kings, Seleucid, the Antiochus. That's, you know, obviously a more detailed unpacking of the chapter, which we're not planning to do tonight. What we want to focus on is the end part, because that's of interest to us, right? So we want to go in at verse 35. This is the context, and we're going to be talking about the end time. So verse 35 says, some of them of understanding shall fail, to try them, to purge, to make them white, even, now here's the key verse, even for the time of the end, because it is yet for a time appointed. So God's saying, look, history's not just going to go on. It's not just random events happening with no direction. These events are happening for the end time. So what's all that about? Well, we're introduced in verse 36 to the king. Right, now, I do want to drill down into this section, because I know for all of us, we probably read Daniel 11 and haven't got a clue what it's about. There's some little interesting points I think we really want to nail tonight. So let's have a look at it. Verse 36, the king. Now, significantly, you'll notice in verse 36, it doesn't say the king of the north or the king of the south, right? So, you know, previously it talks about the kings of the north, the kings of the south, but this one just says, and the king. And the reason why it doesn't say king of the north or south is because he was both. This king had control over north and south. It was the Emperor Constantine who, in verse 37, it says, neither shall he regard the gods of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god. He shall magnify himself above all. Okay, so when you look at this, the terminologies of this particular king, this power, who was actually Constantine, the active words are, he'll exalt himself, he'll magnify himself, he'll speak marvellous things, he'll prosper. Verse 37, he'll magnify himself. Verse 38, he'll take honour to himself. In verse 39, his knowledge will increase with his glory and he'll rule over many. So this is a very dominant and influential king. And of course we know that Constantine was a very powerful influence. Verse 37 says that he won't regard any god. You notice that? Verse 37, he won't regard any god. Now you know from Constantine, he was a religious person, he embraced Christianity. And of course from Constantine was the development of the state church, i.e. the Roman Catholic power, the popes, the stream of popes. And of course, verse 37 says they won't regard any god. Well, you know when a pope is coronated, a tiara is put on his head. And this is the pronunciation that happens at that coronation. When that tiara, the triple tiara, is put on the pope's head, this is what they say. Know thou art father of princes and kings, ruler of the world, vicar of the Saviour, of our Saviour Jesus Christ. Now, you know that word vicar in Latin means instead of. Okay, so you are the representative. You are instead of Jesus Christ, ruler of the world. So there's a lot of titles involved in that. And of course, we know that down through history, that has been the acquisition, stemming from Constantine the King through the Roman Catholic Church, that system. Here, particularly, Pope Pius the 11th says, made this statement, here it is documented, "You know that I am the Holy Father, representative of God on earth, the Vicar of Christ," which means I am God on earth. So you see, here's the fulfillment of these particular events. There's a king and there's going to be a system established that's going to promote itself as above God. And here's the Pope saying that he's above God. I am God. So there's, you know, in a sense, the fulfillment of this particular verse. And as well as that, of course, the king magnifies himself, or that whole system. A little later on, of course, there was the prohibition of books. And because Latin was the language of the church was very protective that it didn't want people to read the Bible, because you know what? They might find out the truth of the Bible. So they prohibited the Bible. So we prohibit also the laity, that means the average person, that's you and me, common people, should be permitted, we don't want that, to have the books of the Old or New Testament. We most strictly forbid them having any translation of these books. So there was an exclusiveness about this power, this system, that Daniel learnt about as the angel revealed to him some of the events that would happen. What is of interest as well is it goes on to talk about he won't have the desire of women. So of course, down through the papacy, there is celibacy as a requirement of the church. Paul comments about that in 2 Timothy chapter 3, forbidding to marry. So this whole system is fulfilling this. But you notice in verse 38, and here's an interesting verse, wonder what you think of this. It says there, "But in his estate he will honour the God of forces, and a God who his fathers knew not." So pagan Rome, of course, didn't have any gods. But all of a sudden, Christianity is embracing this new God. Notice the God of forces. Now, in your margin, you've got a little word, morzim, or God protectors. So the church used saints, they canonised dead saints, as a protective means of establishing and developing the church. So they make all these saints, and that's their defence mechanism. So there's the canonising of saints. So, for example, you might have heard about Saint Christopher, who is a supposed protector when you travel. So for someone that's a devoted Roman Catholic, they might have some sort of icon for Saint Christopher in their car, because he's going to protect them as they travel. So this is the protection that the church established. Many, many saints, so that people could feel comfortable with all these different saints. So the defence, the God protectors, weren't actually swords or guns or mystical powers. They were so-called saints or guardians or miracles, relics and shrines and images. So we've got a lot of different saints that have been created by this powerful influence as a protective mechanism for the church. And of course, you might have heard of the term beatification, which is the process of making people into saints. Now, what's interesting, in the last few years, we've seen a massive rise in that as the Catholic Church has tried to become popular with people. So it goes through this whole process of beatification. Now, look at the stats here. From the 1500s to the 1600s, what is it, 25 maybe saints over 100 years? Not much different in the 1700s. 25 saints over 100 years. Same in the 1800s. In the 1900s through to the year 2000, 130 saints. Beatification. So here's the desperateness of the church in creating all these saints. And of course, in the last 15 years, there's been a dramatic rise, just 80 saints in the last 15 years. So, you know, this is quite incredible. Recently, there was the beatification of Saint Teresa. And this was held, of course, in the Vatican there, St. Peter's Square. Massive, massive involvement of people. What I want you to see, and I'm just paying this to all the relics and the shrines, you notice they come and kiss this, and this little vial here that's supposed to contain the blood of Mother Teresa, and they kiss it, they worship it.
And there the relic is placed in this altar for veneration. Relics are very important. And the blood is contained in a drop.
A vial.
A vial which is in the form of a drop of blood. It's simple and ornate at the same time. It's made out of wood. It comes from different sources, doesn't it?
The pieces of wood are taken from different countries in which the missionaries of Syria.
Free to give, to love, until it hurts. That was one of her
favorite. So you can see this whole process is quite foreign, perhaps, to ourselves. But this is part of the defense mechanism of the church. It's the beatification of saints, this worshipping of shrines and relics, is part of that whole system, which Daniel thought was foretold through the angel. And of course, when I looked this up, I was quite astounded, because not only did they have this particular event, they also had a musical concert in the Vatican itself, which was quite attractive. It's quite entertaining, I guess, and there's a lot of appeal. But we're not really focusing on what the teaching of the Bible is concerned. It's more an entertainment. So that's that particular section there. I was amazed that I've never heard of Rita Ora. Okay, she's a pop singer, a British pop singer. Never heard of her. I actually was watching the clip of the concert, and she was singing in the Vatican. I know she had tattoos on. I thought, wow, that really looks strange. It turns out that she's just a famous British pop singer that the Pope invited to the Vatican to sing on the occasion. And of course, there were people flocking there to listen. So just an amazing system of entertainment, really. So for Daniel, he recognises the development of this particular system. But of course, this brings us really to verse 40, without going too much into the history of the Roman Catholic Church, because verse 40 says, and at that time, the time of the end, so there's a marking point now, the time of the end. At the time of the end shall the king of the south push at him. So you want to have a think about this. So the him, of course, is the context, is the power in Constantinople, Istanbul. That's the power where Constantine sat. And so there's a pushing by a power from the south against, well, this area of Turkey, we would say. So here is the little theme that flows out of this chapter. Daniel is very focused on the time of the end. So you can see right through this section here from verse 35, verse 40, through to chapter 12, Daniel's focused on the time of the end. What's going to happen with the earth? What's going to happen prior to the return of Jesus Christ? Well, let's unpack this verse and find out what's going on. Verse 39. This is the word he, which we recognise is the power that was in the area of the north, Constantinople, Istanbul today, Turkey today. And it says, at the time of the end shall the king of the south push at him. Well, that's the power up there in Constantinople, Istanbul. So there are actually three powers in verse 40. When we look at verse 40, it's not just the king of the north and the king of the south. So let's explain that. At the time of the end shall the king of the south, so there's a foreign power down in Egypt. It's not called Egypt, it's called the king of the south. Interestingly, the king of the south is not mentioned again. So whatever this power is, it's going to exit out of Egypt, because it's called Egypt later on in the chapter when you look down. So that's interesting. Shall push it him. Well, we've already defined that verse 36 as the king, Constantine. The capital was Constantinople in modern Turkey. Okay, so there's going to be a power in Egypt that's going to push at the power that is up there in this particular area, Turkey. And then it says, and the king of the north, well, this is a different power again, will come against him, Turkey, like a whirlwind. Okay, so we're right at this spot. If we want to say, where are we in this verse? Chronologically, we're at this colon, because this event happened the pushing of him happened by the British forces back in 1917 when they pushed the Turkish power back.
Okay.
And so we've got this little note, the power and control of the ancient Seleucid territory. He comes against him, then down to Egypt. It's not called the King of the South, it's Egypt. So the King of the South, this foreign power, has exited. So that's all very interesting. How does that fit into history? Has that happened? Have we seen some of these events come to pass? And the case is certainly true that we've seen that. So the King of the North and the King of the South, they're terms that are only used for a foreign invading force that takes control of that geographic area. So when we hear the King of the South, it means there's a foreign power come into Egypt. So of course, when we think about history and what has happened, we are aware that Britain was in that particular area and it pushed at Turkey back in 1917. So earlier on, of course, Britain had a great interest in particularly the Far East. You know, cups of tea were very important to the British people. So they used to sail their ships all the way around here through to India. So of course, this area here, when the Suez Canal opened up, became particularly significant for Britain. They were very interested in this particular area. Here's the Suez Canal, so it now meant that they could take a shortcut through to India. So there was both a political and an economic interest as far as Britain was concerned, and right through the 1700s, through the 1800s, 1869, when the Suez Gulf was opened up, Britain has been in that area as, we might say, the King of the South. And as we know from history, 1914, World War I, there was some antagonism. The Turkish power sided with the Germans. And of course, there were battles going on. We'd be familiar with Beersheba. 1917, the Australians were involved in that. And of course, that was a pushing back of the King of the North, pushing back. And the Balfour Declaration, of course, happened in 1917 as well, when General Allenby, very significant event, General Allenby, British force, marched into Jerusalem. So pushed the King of the North back, and of course Jerusalem was taken over by the British people. What's interesting, when we read, you know, verse 40 closely, that's the scenario that you would understand. Now what's interesting is Mr. John Thomas, we know him as Brother Thomas, of course, wrote Up as Israel back before any of these events have happened, and he read this verse 40 as we've read it tonight, recognising there's three powers, King of the North, the King, him, and the King of the South. So this is what he says. God who rules the world marks out the bounds of habitation for the nation, will make Britain a gainer by the transaction. He will bring her rulers to see the desirableness of Egypt, Ethiopia, Seba, which will be induced by the force of circumstances probably to take possession of. Okay. They will, however, this is Britain, before the Battle of Armageddon, be compelled to retreat from Egypt and Ethiopia. For, and he quotes this verse, the King of the North will stretch forth his hand upon, and he notes it's the land of Egypt. So he doesn't say the King of the South, so it means Britain's going to be out of there. So very interesting the way, if we read scripture correctly and accurately, we can understand what those events will be. So, of course, as far as the King of the North is concerned, what's of interest to us is that here's the territory of the King of the North. See here in this light green, this is the King of the North territory here. It goes right down to Persia, borders here on India, Pakistan, Afghanistan. So that's the territory of the King of the North. It's not Russia. All right, so you might have read this chapter and always thought, well, the King of the North is talking about Russia. No. This is the King of the North territory here. But what is interesting, in recent times, in the last 12 months, we've seen Russia become the King of the North, because Russia's involved fully in this territory. This is, to me, is amazing. It's exciting. So here is Russia, and Russia, we know, has planted itself here in Syria, which is the ancient territory of the King of the North. And not only that, we know that Russia has strong ties with all these countries here, and well, there's a fairly precarious relationship with Russia and Turkey. What's going to happen there? One wonders. So, of course, as we look at some of these events, what's really exciting to me about verse 40 is for the first time in history we've seen Russia, and we know from Ezekiel 38 that Russia's going to invade the world, invade Israel, the Middle East. We've now seen Russia start to become the king of the north. That's the fulfillment of these verses here. So that's quite astounding. And the reason, of course, Russia has made its entrance into the Middle East, slipped in there without anyone blinking, is because there's a whole pile of problems here with fragmented groups that no one seems to know how to solve. And Russia's said, I'll come in and I will solve these problems. And so it's slid right into the Middle East, in conformity with Ezekiel 38 and with Daniel chapter 11, which we read tonight. So Bible prophecy is coming true. Well, of course, what's going on in the Middle East with all these different fragmented groups? What's going on? Well, here's a simplified view of what's going on. So here are all the groups, and here are the ones that they don't support and they're opposed to. So you can see it's quite simple. It might look a little bit confusing for us, it certainly does, but the angels have it all under control. They know what's going on. For us, of course, humanity, for the governments, for the powers that have invested themselves in the Middle East, well, they want to find out a solution for themselves, and of course it becomes rather confusing. But what we have seen, which is phenomenal, in the last 12 months, September 2015, Russia has slid into the ancient territory and is becoming, for the first time, the king of the north. That's astounding. So let me prove that to you. Russia's interest in Iran, because these are all different territories, Iran, Iraq, Syria, all territories of the ancient king of the north. So here's Russia in Iran. And of course, they were able to use the air bases in Iran to conduct some of their missions. Who knows this time here that Iran had never permitted foreign forces to operate from its soil until now. The reordering of the Middle East is proceeding apace. A Russian-Iran condominium is now dictating events. So although there was some embarrassment with that, because Russia publicly said that, well, we've got an air base in Iran, and Iran, of course, responded, well, you know, let's be careful about that. Nevertheless, of course, there are very strong connections between Russia and Iran. They've got their nuclear reactor that they've built. So there's very strong connections. Ancient territory, the king of the north, Russia's there. Russia in Iraq as well. And of course, they're using that particular area to fly over. They're friendly with the Iraqis, and they allow their bombing runs to go through that particular territory. Russia boosts ties with Iraq in a challenge to US influence, so they're moving into that area. The US has been displaced. And of course, Russia in Syria as well. We would know, well, obviously, that's happened in the last 12 months. So Ezekiel 38 says, be prepared and prepare for thyself, and be a guard unto them. So Russia has slipped in as a guard, as a protectorate of Syria. That's exactly what Ezekiel 38 has said. It's like reading a daily newspaper. We've read Ezekiel 38 for years. All of a sudden, there's a vibrancy and there's a reality to Ezekiel 38 that almost sends shivers up your spine, because they are being a guard. And of course, you'll remember as well, not that long ago, we're only talking, you know, 12 months, that Russia gave a bit of a display of its formidable force and its armaments by firing those missiles from the Caspian Sea. Caspian Sea. And of course, that was not simply as a military maneuver or for precision, it was a demonstration of its capabilities, which is what Ezekiel chapter 38 is all about. So, of course, we witnessed that, and as a commentator says, it wasn't necessary, it was a convincing show of force. It demonstrated Russia's technical superiority over NATO. So this is emerging, which, you know, people have been rather disparaging about Russia. You know, they're all rust buckets, their technology is ancient, they got no idea of, you know, modern armaments. Well, hello, it's wake-up time. War in Syria. Russia's rust bucket military delivers a high-tech shock to the West. What they've seen in Syria and Ukraine has come as a shock, it's eye-watering, it's a game-changer. And of course, there's the quote from Ezekiel 38. We're reading our newspapers in the Bible. What we've seen to come to pass the last 12 months is what Ezekiel 38 has said for thousands of years. All of a sudden, it's a reality. And we're seeing now Russia, who was not the king of the north, now has become, in the last 12 months, has laid a foundation to become the King of the North. It's put a permanent naval base in Syria. So, of course, Russia growls. I like this little comment here. Russia dramatically intervened last year, establishing air base in Syria, launching a savage bombing campaign. Obama did nothing. He said, well, you know, he's going to get into a quagmire, he's going to get bogged down, it's not going to happen. It's going to be a non-event, some quagmire. Consider what Putin has achieved, dealt a weak hand, shorn of empire and saddled with a backward economy and a rusting military. He's restored Russia to great power status. Irrelevant in the 1990s, it's now a force to be reckoned with. He's redrawn the map of Europe. He annexed Crimea. He's threatened retaliation, mass troops. And of course, you know, the world is stepping back and wondering what's going on. Well, we know what's going on because we've read Ezekiel 38. And Ezekiel 38 says you'll be a guard to certain nations. And of course, many years ago, as we know, Robert Roberts wrote about the formidable protectorate that Russia would become for many powers in the Middle East. And he comments by saying Russia will achieve something like universal dominion. So we're just seeing the beginning of this. Now, we believe the return of the Lord Jesus Christ will happen at any moment. We might not see the completion or fulfillment of that. We don't need to. But here's, of course, the response of Obama.
There was some saber rattling between the United States and Russia on the Ukrainian border. Now it's also going on in Syria. You said a year ago that the United States, America leads, we're the indispensable nation. Mr. Putin seems to be challenging that leadership.
In what way? Let's think about
this. He doesn't know really what's going on.
He's moved troops into Syria, for one. Yeah. He's got people on the ground.
Right.
Two, the Russians are conducting military operations in the Middle East for the first time since World War II.
So that's
bombing the people that we are supporting.
So that's leading, Steve? Let me ask you this question. When I came into office, Ukraine was governed by a corrupt ruler who was a stooge of Mr. Putin. Syria was Russia's only ally in the region. And today, rather than being able to count on their support and maintain the base they had in Syria, which they've had for a long time, Mr. Putin now is devoting his own troops, his own military, just to barely hold together by a thread his sole ally.
And he's challenging your leadership, Mr. President. He's challenging your leadership.
Steve, I got to tell you, if you think that running your economy into the ground and having to send troops in order to prop up your only ally is leadership, then we've got a different definition of leadership.
So a different definition of leadership, correct, because he's saying Mr. Putin's hanging on by a thread in the Middle East. Well, everyone else is looking at the Middle East and doesn't look like a thread at all. So, of course, perhaps that's a response in the recent elections with Mr. Trump as to why America has resolved to go down a different pathway. And they've elected Mr. Trump. It'll be interesting to see what his response is to NATO and to the Middle East. But, of course, we're talking about the ancient territory of the King of the North, which Russia is sliding into. What about Turkey? You know, because, again, Ezekiel 38 talks about Russia coming down into that area and also here in Daniel chapter 11. Well, it's very tenuous. And remember when the Turkish Air Force shot down a Russian jet, I was a little bit nervous because I thought Russia would invade Turkey, and I'm thinking, wow, we didn't think we'd even see that. So it's a very a tenuous relationship, and of course Mr. Putin says we'll remind them many a time what they've done. They will more than once feel regret for what they've done. We are perfectly aware of what action has to be taken. So he hasn't forgotten that particular incident at all. And of course, there's little comments here in the recent civil disturbance. Remember, just a few months ago, there was a civil disturbance right through Turkey, and Mr. Erdogan sacked 30% of his high-rating generals and military staff, which was astounding. There was fear that Russian President Putin was about to test the unity of NATO with an attack on Turkey. So, people were worried that he was going to go into Turkey in a moment of Turkish weakness and invade that particular country. We know that one day will happen, according to Ezekiel 38 and Daniel chapter 11. So, of course, it's a very tenuous relationship. Not only that, of course, but Mr. Putin is promoting himself as the protector of Christianity. So again, there's another big dimension there. He's appealing to many Middle Eastern people as the defender of Christianity, and they're looking to Putin for salvation and protection, which was not offered to them by the West. So a massive geopolitical shift in the way people are thinking about Mr. Putin and what he can offer. But of course, this verse here in Daniel chapter 11 says he'll come like a whirlwind. Did you notice that in verse 40? It says he'll come like a whirlwind. Well, a whirlwind takes you by surprise. Okay, so that's exactly what John Thomas, Brother Thomas, said many years ago. The policy of the autocrat, that is the Russian ruler, will throw his adversaries off their guard and take the Sultan, the Turkish ruler, by surprise, and he'll come like a whirlwind. So that's written 160 years ago. So we're not just getting on the bandwagon because, you know, stuff's happened the last 12 months, we need to update. Written 160 years ago by a Bible student who opened Daniel 11 and said, oh, it says he'll come like a whirlwind. So that must mean, and we're seeing that come to pass. We haven't seen the invasion, but it will happen. That Russia is making a thrust for global dominion, particularly in the Middle East, is absolutely evident by this here. You might remember that a few months ago, did you remember listening to some media about the British Navy escorting the Russian aircraft carrier down through Britain? They were a little bit worried about it. So Russia has sent its only aircraft carrier down through the Middle East, and that's quite unusual. This is an old diesel aircraft carrier. It's used for cold water. They say that it needs a lot of repair and refueling. It's never been operationally tested. Why would he send an aircraft carrier down to the Middle East? Because they already have air superiority in Syria. So why would they send an aircraft carrier down there? And here's the journey. You might remember there they were escorted. So he sent his only aircraft carrier down to the Middle East. So this is what the newspaper report says. It's a potent symbol of the Kremlin's intention to continue influencing events in that region. So, you know, it's worthless. It's an old, rusting aircraft carrier, but they're sending a signal to the rest of the world as, hey, this is our area. We're taking control of the Middle East. And here in this little section here, it says, by sending Admiral Kuznetsov, this is the aircraft carrier, to the Mediterranean, Putin is saying to the world, but first of all to his own citizens, that Russia once again has superpower aspirations. Pretty astounding, huh? Because this is what is in Daniel chapter 11. And of course, when we join together Ezekiel 38, which we're not considering tonight, but we did on Tuesday night with Carl at the town hall. And of course, when we parallel that with Daniel chapter 11, we see that dovetails perfectly. So what we've been talking about and thinking about tonight, King of the North, Russia now, who hasn't been the King of the North until it's moved into that territory, now we're starting to see that come to fulfilment. So, of course, that's an amazing thing. So for ourselves, of course, there's a number of prophetic signs that have come to pass. We're thinking about 2016, thinking about 2017, what's going to happen? Well, let me just show you what has happened. Are we living in end times? Well, we're looking at some of the prophecies that were given. 500 years before Christ, major prophets talked about some prophecies. When did they come to fulfillment? Well, one of them, of course, was the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ in AD 70. That was a prophecy. Well, nothing was fulfilled for a long, long time until 1948. You know, 1900 years went by, a big space, before the next fulfillment of a prophecy. Then we move on a little bit, of course, and we start to see some major fulfillments. Again, Luke 21 in 1967. So 30 or 40 years later, another prophecy was fulfilled. So the gap shortened a little bit, right? So it's not a 1,000 or 1,900 years gap. And gradually, as we see some of these events that have been happening, of course, the gap is getting closer and closer. And so we come sort of to times of terrorism, which we haven't seen before, which Luke 21 said, men's hearts failing for fear. That's starting to happen now in a very real way. A lot of changes with the environment, some in the areas of the religious sphere, and of course right through the Middle East here, some massive changes. You know, game changes. When Israel finds a gas field, Egypt's found a large gas field. That's very tempting, isn't it, for someone who's interested in gas. Russia's entered the Middle East. We haven't talked about that tonight. Western needs refugees sweep across Europe. You know, the sea and the waves roaring. Well, that's social unrest. We've seen it in the massive shift of refugees across the face of Europe. And civil unrest in Turkey. Wow, you know, who knows what the next move will be. Will it be for Mr. Putin to go into Turkey? Because that's exactly where he's going to go one day. But we think Jesus will return before then. So, you know, what's the future for 2017? Well, I don't know whether Mr. Trump is going to get on horseback with Mr. Putin. Maybe they will. Maybe they won't. I don't know. Peace on earth? Probably not. I don't think with these two gentlemen anyway. Or maybe it'll be something different and Mr. Trump will end up being a pet monkey. I'm not quite sure where all the fluctuation of these little incidental events will happen, but we know the big picture. We know the big picture. We know that Jesus Christ is going to come back. And Daniel chapter 11 is an amazing piece of evidence that shows that Russia one day will become the king of the north. And we've seen it in the last 12 months. It's astounding. So the message of the Bible to us tonight is we need to get ready. Paul says those signs are going to get closer and closer. He said it's going to be like the birth pangs of a woman going into labour prior to the birth of the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we've actually seen that. Those previous slides showed the big gaps, and then things are getting closer and they're happening quickly now. So we believe the return of the Lord Jesus Christ is very close at hand. So what of 2017? Well, it's important for us, brothers and sisters and friends, that we make changes in our life now so that when our Lord Jesus Christ returns, we can be ready for him and we can help in providing real solutions to today's world.
BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is a worldwide collaboration by Christadelphians to help promote the understanding of God's Word to those who are seeking the truth about the human condition and God's plan and purpose with this earth and with mankind upon it. Bible Truth and Prophecy is part of a wider set of online resources provided by Christadelphianvideo.org. For establishing just how far removed the true Christian teaching of the first century apostles is from that taught by mainstream Christendom today. BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is very much a standalone website, but benefits from our vast network of sites and resources and social media. Here are just a few of the things that BibleTruthAndProphecy.com offers. We have a good number of written articles supplied to us from brothers from all over the globe. These deal with first principle issues, creation versus evolution, the inspiration of the Bible, and so much more. We have a whole section of video study series. These are studies that have been posted onto our YouTube channel, but because of the difficulty of the search feature within YouTube, we have chosen to host on Bible Truth and Prophecy. So now, every video you search for within the site, you can be guaranteed that it will be of a Christadelphian nature. We also have a preaching video section, where any ecclesia is invited to download and use or embed these videos within their own ecclesial websites. We also have an exhortation service, where we produce two or three exhortations per week, which we then circulate to brethren and sisters in isolation. We also have an ever-growing list of approved Christadelphian sites. We also have a page of live news feeds, so you can keep up to date with all the breaking news as it happens. We also have a section for the daily readings. Each day at around midnight, we publish all three of the daily readings. And then later on in the day, we publish Thought for the Days, often based on all three portions of the daily readings. Within each daily reading post, there is also a link to enable you to have the Bible chapter read to you directly. We also feature Bible in the News videos, videos which we have produced from the Bible in the News website. We also feature Brother Don Pierce's milestone snippets, which come out approximately three times a week. We also feature Andy Walton's weekly World Watch, and other commentaries and analysis from other brethren on world news events. You can also subscribe to the blog and be notified of posts as they happen in real time, and also subscribe to the weekly newsletter, which is provided by christadelphianvideo.org. Every page and post on the site has the facility to be able to leave a comment or make an observation, so please take advantage of this and let us know what you think of the site.